Krishna Saha Sarvaikarya Krishna Shastra Devotional service to satisfy the senses of the Lord. The members of the Krishna consciousness movement must be alert in regard to this point. And then their preaching of the Krishna consciousness movement will be successful. Hari Om Tat Sat. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Swami translation purport of the Srimad Bhagavatam, 8th canto, 8th chapter, 29th to 38th verse. In the matter of churning of the milk ocean. Put on the board, 29 to 38, so we know we'll start from 29 tomorrow. The demons took Varuni. 29 to 38. So, according to their interest, everyone was taking. Now, when the nectar came out, it was supposed to be distributed evenly. But the demons broke the rules. And they stole the nectar. So then the demigods, they were very frustrated. What happened here? I want to make sure the demons come and work so hard that they get done anything. And these demons are going to get, they're going to become so powerful. They're going to harass everybody in the universe. Because they're drinking the nectar. So many things they could anticipate. So, demons cheated. So then the Lord reciprocated. So he's also cheating them. And then the next thing happens will be that Mohini Vati will manifest. But before that, everybody, even though they have the nectar, they can enjoy it peacefully. Everybody sit down, take a share. Everybody's fighting. You know, who are you to take it first? You're just a, you know, bum. I should take it first. I'm stronger than you. I'm better than you. So everybody's fighting who gets the nectar first. So we have to be very careful, because within us we also have this tendency, demonic nature and demonic nature, both are there. In Kali Yuga, generally we find this mix. In previous yugas it was very clear, okay, this is a devotee and this is a demon. But now everybody has a little bit of the mix, more or less. So the demonic thoughts sometimes come into the mind, very materialistic thoughts can come into our mind. You know, maybe you know somebody here, maybe you know anybody that has ever had a materialistic demonic thought come into mind. So we have to purify the mind. We have to be very careful. So Krishna Prabhupada gave him the secret that we, the devotees, they are alert to surrendering at the lotus feet of Krishna. We want to do what's pleasing to Krishna. Even if the mind comes up with some thought, let's do this thing. Let's take vengeance, or let's enjoy, or let's give up everything because we don't need anything anymore. All kinds of extreme decisions without really thinking what's pleasing to Krishna. That's the problem. And the body is thinking how to please the Lord. But the demons are thinking how to enjoy sense gratification. Personal sense gratification. So then some people, there's a mix, right, you see. They like to help other people a little bit. Not because they want to please the Lord, but because they're against them. I'm going to make them happy. It's the right thing to do. So it's also for their own sense gratification, but more goodness. When we do things specifically to please the Lord, then that's pure devotional service. So since the International Society for Krishna Consciousness is dedicated to pure devotional service, the members of the Krishna Consciousness movement must be alert. You must be alert in regard to disappointment. Or disappoint. Everybody wants to enjoy and satisfy his own senses. Therefore, unless such demons become Krishna conscious and are trained to satisfy the senses of the Lord, there can be no question of peace in human society or in any society, even that of the demigods. So, how many here want peace on earth? If you'd like to see the people peaceful, have a peaceful world where everybody engages in Krishna consciousness, well, this is the secret. You can't have any peace in any society unless the people are trained to be Krishna conscious. And trained to do what? Satisfy whose senses?
Krishna.
Krishna. You're sure? But satisfying your neighbor's senses is just as good as what Krishna did. Can't satisfy Krishna, then in the 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, I know this to be charitable, but actually, satisfying Krishna's senses is something very special. Directly engaging in devotional service. But that's the thing that mostly everybody neglects. I was even discussing with one priest, and he would also say, what is this serving God? It's very distant, but we can serve our neighbor right there. He was preaching to me how basically, so he didn't really think that God was very relevant. As a priest, not to speak of others. So I mean, it's very difficult to find who's going to train the demons? Who's going to find the trainers of the demons? To train them to satisfy Krishna. Demons are not going to be very interested. Prahlad was trying to train demons, but it was quite a dangerous situation, right? When he trained all the children of the demons. They're wondering who is infiltrating the Gurukul and teaching them. So Hiranyakashipu had the secret servicemen completely surrounding the school and looking out, no Vaishnava enters in to pollute the demon. With an order, shoot on site order. Shoot first, ask questions later. Of course, they didn't know that inside the Lord was training everyone to serve Krishna. Demons are now generally opposed to that. But somehow or other, the demon also engages in Krishna. So there's no such prejudice that anybody cannot be a devotee. Some of the greatest devotees were also born in the demon families. Bali Maharaj, Prahlad. So, we need to take steps to see that all this divine nature of us is purified for us. Even the demigods, sometimes they're having quarrels because they're not pure devotees. Generally, demigods are sakam bhaktas. They're devotees with some desires. And then when they whatever you have, your personal interests about Krishna, so there's always a chance for deceit. There's always a chance for envy, fighting, disagreement. Somehow the world is really being not properly managed. And Krishna gets the bad rap, really. Everyone blames God, why does people suffer? But statistically, there's enough food in the world to feed everybody. In fact, in some of the countries, they pay you not to grow food. I don't do that here, but they do that in Europe and America. If you are normally growing some product and then if you agree not to grow it, then sometimes they give you money. They want to keep the supply down and the price high. If you flood the market, then they're afraid there will be some hardship on their economy. And I heard in America they have caves filled with, someone told me billions, I don't know, billions or millions of tons of ghee, or water ghee. This take it off the market to keep the price above their high. And they take out shiploads of grain and dump it in the ocean. If there's people in the world who can't have enough to eat. I mean, they're putting their country's interests, their economy, above all these other people that are starving. If it's Krishna's interest, then Krishna wants to see everybody pay. Because if somebody would actually distribute the food to the hungry people, then there's a way you can get that grain before they throw it. Pay 0.5%. 0.5% of the total grain is earmarked for giving away. 0.5%. But that's still so much. So much food is produced. Once you're talking about Prabhupada, because there was a devotee who was working on this, Tantra Vidas or something. And he said we could get a shipload of corn, a shipload of wheat, and a shipload of rice, plus ghee. So when Prabhupada about the ghee, he said, okay, bring over a shipload of ghee and give everybody in Calcutta one can. Be pretty good publicity. The name of Krishna. Give everyone the name of Krishna, give them one. Here you go. Then when he heard about the grains, he also said, okay, you have all the grains. It was too good. Somehow, I don't know what happened, but the devotee was not able to. I think the problem was where to keep all the food grains. It required gigantic warehouses. So then we made a deal with the Food Corporation in India that we could deposit the food grains any port in India, and we could pull out their food grains from any FCI warehouse. And then that was already too late. But by that time, that person was doing it. Never happened. Maybe there's ways you can be done to decide your crossways and get some subsidized rules. So we need to engage people's senses, possessions, like in your story, it says how much Lakshmi is liberated. Sita was captured by Ravana, so liberating Sita, liberating the Lakshmi. We have to be very careful ourselves to use it, use the Lakshmi for Krishna's service wisely. This way, the world continues. If we see the difference, what's the difference? What's the difference between the devotee and the non-devotee? The devotee wants to please Krishna's senses, and the devotee wants to please your own senses. Someone may think, I'm a devotee. But then if they're acting selfishly, and then acting to please Krishna, then they're not acting like a devotee. That's the problem. So we need to know what it is to be a devotee, and we need to act like that. As soon as we start to desire our own sense gratification, we immediately put in anxiety on problems like that. We immediately put in anxiety because our nature is like that. If we want something that we don't have, then we're in anxiety how we get it. If we get it, we're in anxiety or how to lose it. When we lose it, we're in anxiety, I lost it, I'm lamenting, how am I going to begin? So this material world is a very anxious place. Unless the people engage in Krishna service. But as good as the spiritual world is. In the spiritual world, everybody's engaging in Lord's service. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, let's say he taught his followers that they should be selfless. They should do things for their own sense gratification. There was a time that, even sometimes it's very subtle. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains how there was this yogi who came. I told the story many times, but I'm here, I'm not sure. This yogi, young brahmachari, came to Srivas and said, I'd like to join the kirtan. He said, well, it's only for the devotees. You're practicing some other yoga. Bhakti yoga, so you're not really very confidential. So, well, okay, maybe I can't attend, but could I watch from your window? He said, all right. This year's brahmachari is a very exception. But, she must have known what was going to happen. That evening when Lord Chaitanya and the devotees arrived and they started doing the kirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Chanting, and he said, I don't feel ecstasy today.
Who is responsible here? Why don't I feel any ecstasy today? Every day I'm feeling ecstasy. Why today I'm not feeling ecstasy? Who is responsible? Who's the one?
Of course, Lord Chaitanya didn't have to point because everybody, the devotees automatically saw him. They think, well, what did I do wrong today? Must be me, I'm the most fallen here. So, everyone points the finger first at himself, right? That's. Then Srivas, well, there's a brahmachari in the. Looking through the window. No, brahmachari, bring this brahmachari. Who is this person? So they bring out this Astanga yoga brahmachari. He's wearing bark. He's so austere, instead of wearing clothes, he's wearing tree bark. He wouldn't be allowed to enter into Australia because tree bark is a quarantined item. So there wasn't a problem with Nandaji. But anyway, still he was a tree bark, and he had his kamandalu stick, and he had his water pot. So he came out and landed here. Came out. So then the voice said, "So who are you?" "And I'm a yogi, brahmachari." And she said, "What yoga you practice?" He said, "Well, mystical yoga." "What do you do?" "I live in the forest. I eat the berries and the leaves and the fruit from the forest." "What's your goal?" "Well, I want to become self-realized." "What are you doing here, Mamazi?" "You see, you don't have an answer for this. So it's obvious you're coming here because you want people to respect you. You don't get any name and fame in the forest. When you come out and people saw you, here's a yogi, very austere, then they respect you and give donations and so on. You're here because of the desire for name and fame, not because of your actual desire to understand the purpose." Like that, Lord Chaitanya has shown the door. He's not qualified to be here right here to this. Then the devotees were chanting inside of him, and then the yogi got put out the door. Boom! "See you later, sorry." Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama. Kirtan was going on ecstatically inside now. And the yogi was sitting outside and he said, "Wow, I really got blasted." He gave me the sauce. But what he said was true. "I don't have a taste sitting in the forest meditating. It's very dry." And so I came into the city for a break, and actually those devotees, when they were chanting Hare Krishna, they were so focused. They're actually much greater yogis in the Vedic chanting. They were very much peaceful and detached. I'm very fallen, it's true. I don't know. Well, I can't understand. How was I given even this opportunity to see the Kirtan for some minutes? So they see that by seeing that Kirtan, that my identity has become completed. The Lord Chaitanya stopped the Kirtan and said, "Where's the yogi?" "He's outside, he's been outside." "Okay, now you can bring him in." Because the yogi was feeling so fallen, so unqualified, he started to cry. "And how I got so much mercy, even though I didn't deserve it, I'm so fallen, I got this mercy, I could see the beautiful kirtan." So because his consciousness had changed to something in harmony with Krishna's, was in a demanding nature, he was in some heavy pushing nature, but he was very much reoriented with. And then Lord Chaitanya brought him in, and he joined the kingdom, and after that he became an associate. So the only thing that keeps us from being a devotee is our consciousness, is our mind. If we can change our perspective, our viewpoint, then we're a devotee. Devotee wants to please Krishna. Devotee is grateful to Krishna. We want to see Krishna. So this is what we've been very careful from. Root out all the demoniac thoughts from our heart. Reject them. If they pop up, just to harass us, just to test us. No, that's not what I want. A lot of sort of the material body, these thoughts may come in our minds. To enjoy, to get vengeance, to be angry, to some. Rajasic, tamasic, or some. Non-devotional sattvic thought may come in the mind. But we have to deal with that either by preaching to our mind or just by disowning intuition by praying. It's not the good thing. And devotees, they want to say that tradition is to feed the guest first and be last. Here everybody is afraid that the big guy, big people will take first, they won't be waiting for me. And Radharani, the leader of the devotees, is discussing it, so she does everything for Krishna.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.